My name is Marsha Aizumi, and I'm here. I have a transgender son, and I'm very happy to be here today with all of you with this workshop. So what we have today is three different individuals that are going to be sharing their story and giving you perspectives. We have a father, we have a mother, and we have a family member. Also, the same three people are two ministers, so they'll be bringing a little bit of their faith perspective. And also, we have a fellow mother activist, Laurin. And so we're hoping through this workshop, you're just going to hear different stories of ways that family have accepted, different journeys that people have gone through. And then what we're going to do is, after that, we're going to break down into a little bit smaller groups, because sometimes talking in a big group is like really hard. So we'll have like the panelists in each smaller group. They can answer some questions. We can have some discussions. They have some prompts that they'll throw out to the group if nobody has any questions or anything that they want to talk about. So I would like to go ahead and get started. I want to introduce them, but I'm not going to do the bios. I'm going to let them share about themselves through the story. And I'm going to start over here with Reverend Nobuaki Hanaoka. And then to his right, we have Reverend John Oda. And then we have Laurin Mayeno. So I'm going to have Reverend Hanaoka start. And then we'll move to your right after that. Okay?
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Marsha. My name is Nobu Hanaoka. I'm a retired United Methodist minister. When my youngest child, the youngest of three, was 15, I was in Sacramento serving a church there alone. The rest of my family stayed in the Bay Area. And one day, my daughter, Mioi, called me and said that, I'd like to stay a few days with you. Is it okay? So I said, sure. I actually welcome that. And we had a wonderful week, you know, going out, eating out every day, and having fun together. And then she went home. And as soon as she got home, she emailed me and saying, what I wanted to tell you was that I'm gay. Is it okay? You know, by that time, I was known as an activist to make our churches more inclusive of the LGBTQ people, and more welcoming and more affectionate. And I had done, she knew that I had done some union blessing of union of the same-sex people. But she couldn't tell that, her own sexuality, in my face. I wrote to her, of course it's okay, I love you anyway. And it must have taken you a lot of courage, first of all, to affirm yourself as a gay person, to come out openly in spite of the negative attitudes in the society. And I told her that I was very, very proud of her. You know, her courage and her honesty. And after that, almost some evolution began to take place. Personal transformation in her was amazing. Up to that point, in the first 15 years of her life, she was very quiet, very reserved, and she was unhappy. She looked unhappy. And sometimes I felt she was avoiding us, because soon after we finished the dinner, she would go into her room and wouldn't show herself to us. But after she came out, she became more positive, affectionate, compassionate, open, and understanding of many issues and assertive as well. In that almost full blossom, blossoming took place. You know, this is what self-affirmation and the family acceptance does to anybody. When she came out, when she took the courage to come out, I said to myself, I have to come out as a parent or a proud parent of a gay child. She now identifies herself as queer. So at that point, she felt she was a lesbian. But anyway, regardless how she identifies herself, it's okay with me. I want her to fulfill her life. I want her to be happy. And I think that's what family or parents especially feel about their children. So I came out as a proud parent of a gay child. I was in a church, a little bit more conservative than the Bay Area, Sacramento. I had no problem. And because I came out, a few other people came out. To tell you the truth, my child is gay. And I haven't told anybody because I'm ashamed. So I said, don't be ashamed. Your child has to live herself. When she accepts her own self, when you accept her own self, she will accept herself, or he will accept himself. Then fullness of life comes. And I'm glad that I came out. Even though, you know, I had some people who were against me. After Sacramento, I moved to Berkeley, and a rather large church, well-known, predominantly Caucasian church. And then I had some flags, you know, but in the back of my back. Behind me, they're talking, you know, Reverend Hanaoka is supporting gay people. Don't let our Boy Scouts come close to him. I think that's a typical response. And yet, I didn't bother me because I knew I was right. And I did some serious research into the Bible. The New Testament doesn't say anything about gay sexuality. There's one that seems to be saying something like that, but it's not about sexuality at all. It's a Hellenistic thing. Old Testament, there's only one book of Leviticus that talks a lot about it. They say homosexuality is an abomination. But the book of Leviticus lists 55 abominations, including talking back to the parents. And they don't say anything about the rest of the abominations. They only pick one, homosexuality. But the New Testament, that Jesus doesn't say anything about sexuality. What he says is loving. To be loving, more compassionate, more accepting. And it's wrong to use the Bible to discriminate against a whole lot of people, respectable, compassionate, decent people. So that's my story.
I'm gonna sit down if that's okay. My name is John Oda. I'm the pastor of a church called Lake Park United Methodist Church in Oakland. And I first want to say thank you to Marsha for inviting me to be on this panel. Marsha and I both sit on the National P-Flag Board, and it's been great to get to know you and Aiden. I was at the Okai conference down in Southern California, and one of the things I said just slipped out. And I hope you don't take offense to this, but I wish we didn't have to have these kind of conferences. I wish this just wasn't an issue, you know? But it is. It's like, you know, I wish race wasn't an issue, but it is. So I kind of have an interesting story. A very dear family member of mine came out in the 80s. I think it was the 80s. And, you know, the whole family knew that she was lesbian. And so when she came out, it wasn't a big deal. It's like, oh, finally, you know, you admit it. And just like Reverend Hanaoka just described, Miyori, her life blossomed. You know, she really basically, I think, became who, and this is my term, who God created her to be. So she had a wonderful, she was very shy, very withdrawn, and when she came out, she just developed a very big social life, or a bigger social life. And then she started attending a very conservative church. And lo and behold, she came home one day and she said, she had a talk with me and she said, you know, homosexuality is a sin. I almost choked on my food. I was like, what? Are you kidding? Yeah, you know, the church I'm attending is, they were preaching this. They were, unfortunately, giving the message to the congregants. I think, in my opinion, I think homophobia, the root cause of it, is the churches, in my opinion. That the churches take the Bible and twist it, as Reverend Hanaoka illustrated. And so a lot of, if not all, of homophobia has its seeds from these churches, these conservative churches. So basically back into the closet. I'm actually not sure where she is. We haven't had a conversation lately. She's kind of been hanging around with this woman, and I'm like, oh, what's going on there? But for me, I kind of didn't really think about the issue of being LGBT. It was kind of like being a white man. I don't have to think about being, you know, a person of color. So I started to do a lot of research, and I found out that my church, the United Methodist Church, doesn't allow gay or lesbians to be ordained. And I said, that's just not right. So I started to get involved with something called Reconciling Ministries, which is an organization which works alongside of the United Methodist Church for full inclusion of LGBT persons. So I'm born and raised in California. My first board meeting was in New Orleans or something with the Reconciling Ministries Network. And I just have to tell the story because for those of you who are in California, the rest of the country is scary. Yeah. I mean, there are parts of it that are just friggin' scary. So we're sitting around this table, and the guy next to me on the board is from Savannah, Georgia. He has given me permission to tell the story. And they're passing around the board roster, and it says Reverend such and such and his partner's name. And he looks at it and he starts crying. And I'm like, wow, what's up with, you know, with them? And he tells a story that he has never seen Reverend and his partner's name on the same line. And when he told that, I said, you know what, I'm not in California anymore. There is, and unfortunately, my time on the Reconciling Ministries board and on PFLAG, I've just heard horrendous stories of people being kicked out of the church, time and time again, of youth ministers being asked to leave, pastors being outed, being defrocked. It's just, it's sad.
Suicides,
yeah, the worst, the most heartbreaking stories are the suicides I've heard about. So I think there's a lot of work to still be done in the church and in the society. As probably many of you know, there are a lot of unfortunate very disheartening. Bathroom bills being introduced across the country, kind of as a backlash to same-sex marriage. And the United Methodist Church itself is really gearing up to put a stop to transgender persons being ordained.
No matter what our argument is, I'm going to offer that to you.